Good afternoon, colleagues. Can I remind members that COVID measures are in place and face covering should be worn while moving around the chamber and across the Holyrood campus. The next item of business is portfolio questions, and the portfolio is education and skills. I would remind any members wishing to ask a supplementary to press the request to speak buttons or put an R in the chat function at the appropriate question. And I call question number one, Annabel Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the Young Persons Guarantee Scheme.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
Since the launch of the Young Persons Guarantee in November 2020, we have invested an additional £130 million, which aims to provide at least 24,000 new and enhanced opportunities for young people. An update was provided in the Young Persons Guarantee Implementation Progress Report published in July, demonstrating that we have delivered that 100-day commitment. We now have over 200 employers signed up to the guarantee to support young people in their communities, as well as DYW school coordinators in every mainstream secondary school.
Annabel Ewing.
I thank the Minister for that answer, and it would be helpful if further specific information could be provided as to the rollout of the Young Persons Guarantee Scheme in Fife. And in particular, can the Minister advise as to what he will do to ensure that the opportunity for real job progression is built into the guarantee scheme so that it can be truly life-changing for the young people concerned?
Minister.
Well, first of all, let me acknowledge Annabel Ewing's long-standing interest in this area. She's been a real champion for developing young workforce in Fife, and indeed they piloted the schools coordinator's role that I've mentioned, and I know she was very keen to see that approach embedded. In terms of what's happening in Fife, a number of actions have been taken forward by partners there, supporting young people to access short industry-focused courses on subjects including digital literacy, data science and security. They provide SQA qualifications to support young people to access higher skilled and better paid employment as they progress through their careers. There's also been a particular focus on support for mental health and those living in deprivation to ensure that additional barriers are eliminated. And I've also been very clear that all of this approach must ensure meaningful opportunities that are sustainable and enduring. That's as true in Fife as it is across the entirety of the country.
Thank you, Minister. Question number two, Willie Rennie.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how it plans to implement the recommendations by the OECD on the Scottish National Standardised Assessments in its report, Scotland's Curriculum for Excellence into the Future.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government has welcomed the OECD's independent review and has accepted all of its recommendations in full. We continue to consider carefully all of the observations in the OECD report.
Willie Rennie.
National assessments were originally introduced by Margaret Thatcher's government before they were scrapped by the Liberal Democrat Labour government here because they resulted in crude league tables. The recent OECD's report criticised the use of the Scottish government's assessments for national monitoring purposes, and now we have crude league tables once again. Why is the Education Secretary more persuaded by the logic of Margaret Thatcher than the OECD?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Willie Rennie for that question? Can I make clear, as I did in committee yesterday, that the purpose of national standardised assessments is primarily formative. The OECD made no recommendations about standardised assessments. We will consider the commentary in the report, but it did recognise within that they are a valuable tool to support teachers' judgment. We are keen to ensure that OECD's recommendation about what we can do with data and do it effectively is considered. That work is ongoing. But as I made clear to Willie Rennie yesterday in committee, and I'm therefore confused about why we're having the same conversation today, the Scottish Government does not collect and therefore does not publish the standardised assessment.
Thank you. And a couple of supplementaries. First, Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary is either in denial or keen to hide her government's dire record when it comes to education. We need to have the right data for the right purpose, and any Cabinet Secretary serious about restoring standards across our education system would want to end the data desert. So why won't the Cabinet Secretary get a refreshed SSLN back up and running and rejoin the internationally respected TIMSS and PIRLS assessments?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I start with a degree of consensus? I absolutely do believe we should have the right data for the right purpose. Since the introduction of the National Improvement Framework in 2016, there has been an increase in the data and wider performance information that is collected by the Scottish Government. And of course, the Scottish Government continues to participate in the largest international survey, the PISA survey as well. As I said, I think at committee again, yesterday, presiding officer, we did undertake to reconsider the merits of SNLN compared to ASL in response to a former Education and Skills Committee inquiry. That work is ongoing. It had been delayed during the pandemic, but we will respond on this and on other methods, on other recommendations and commentary in the OECD report in due course.
Thank you. And Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary how the Scottish Government plans to engage with stakeholders, including children and young people, as we move forward with education reform?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it is very, very important that we engage with stakeholders and groups, because there are a variety of different opinions on different areas of education reform. Professor Ken Muir, for example, is the independent advisor that I have asked to come in, and he is engaging widely to understand the needs of schools, practitioners and, very importantly, learners, as we look to design our new national education agencies and what they will look like in the future. He has recently published a consultation on that issue, and I also intend for the Scottish Education Council, the key strategic stakeholder forum for oversight of improvement activity in Scotland, to have a key role in this, as will the once established Children and Young People's Education Council too.
Question number three, Sue Webber.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to ensure the future workforce can have access to vocational skills training in light of the current staff shortages in certain sectors.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
Ensuring a sustainable workforce supply requires continued investment and collaboration across the system to ensure provision is aligned to economic and social need. That's why we've committed an additional £500 million investment across this parliamentary term to support new, good, green jobs of the future, including £20 million this year through the National Transition Training Fund for sectors impacted by the pandemic and Brexit. We'll also continue to urge the UK Government to rethink post-Brexit immigration policy to prevent labour shortages from undermining our recovery.
Sue Webber.
I thank the Minister for his answer, but the issues I'm raising today existed long before Brexit. There's been a sharp decline in the number of students in further education during the pandemic, and the number of 16-year-olds enrolled full-time at college has fallen by nearly a quarter in the last decade. With businesses also struggling, how will the Scottish Government support these very businesses and their apprenticeship schemes to ensure all our young people have the best opportunities as they leave school?
Minister.
Well, we'll do what we've always done. We'll continue to invest in apprenticeships and apprentices in the country, and that's the approach we have always taken and continue to do. Of course, we have seen some disruption in the last year. How could we have seen anything other, given the impact of COVID-19? But I'm pleased to be able to tell Ms. Webber that as of the first quarter of this year, we see 3.7 times the number of modern apprenticeship starts than we did last year. So we are recovering, and we'll continue to work to that end.
And a brief supplementary, Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how many children are leaving school to positive destinations.
Minister.
The 2019-20 data, the latest available, showed that 92.2% of school leavers were in a positive destination at the 9-month point after the end of the school year. The 2021 figures will be available in due course. I believe these figures are reflective of the resilience and tenacity of young people in Scotland and indeed our education system as a whole.
Question number four, Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to support lifelong learning and reskilling in Argyll, Bute and other rural areas.
Minister.
We are making significant investments to ensure that people of all ages in rural communities have the right skills now and in the future to support a recovery and transition to net zero. Argyll and Bute is covered by 6 Skills Development Scotland career centres in Campbelltown, Rothsay, Isla, Dunoon, Helensburgh and Oban. They play a critical role in guiding people to skills opportunities. Since the individual training account scheme began in 2017, we have invested nearly £100,000 of support to learners in Argyll and Bute. And over the next 10 years, through the growth deal, we've committed £25 million in the region, supporting a rural skills accelerator programme with a mobile STEM academy, learning hubs and a rural enterprise accelerator programme.
Jenny Minto.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Both Argyll College and the Scottish Association for Marine Science provide a variety of courses across a number of locations within Argyll and Bute to local people and those from out with the area. I recently took part in a roundtable meeting with SAMHS to discuss the lack of student accommodation. Can the Minister outline what support is available to colleges to provide suitable living accommodation for students?
Minister.
Well, in the first instance, I would always encourage any students who are worried about their housing situation to seek advice and support from the institution they attend. The issues within Jenny Minto's question are important, though, Presiding Officer, and that's why our programme for government commitment to review purpose-built student accommodation and our 100 days commitment to establish the next stage of this is already underway and will be taken forward in parallel with work to ensure rent affordability and improving standards across the private rented sector.
A couple of supplementaries. First, Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In the summer, I had the pleasure of visiting the award-winning Glogburn Farm Shop in Perthshire, and the owners told me how difficult it is to recruit butchers within their local area. According to a survey by Meat Business, 37% of women believe they would face barriers to success because of their gender, and 80% believe they are unable to see role models in the sector who would encourage them to join. So can I ask the Minister, in light of this long-standing issue with shortage of butchers, especially female butchers, what support does the Scottish Government offer to help women and young people reskill in rural areas to become butchers?
Minister.
We are committing £300,000 this financial year to bring about practical solutions to support women in the agricultural sector in the wider sense, including Argyll and Bute, where the original question about, and indeed Perthshire, where the supplementary question is about. This will include the wider rollout of the Be Your Best Self personal development training, a pilot of business skills training, and a range of other activities. So I recognise the challenges that Ms Hamilton has laid out. They are ones we must respond to, and that's exactly what we're doing.
Well done on knitting those questions together. And Martin Whitfield.
Thank you, DPO, and I'll allow the Minister to extend slightly further. Young people from rural parts of Scotland who want to stay in their area already struggle to get apprenticeships or studies that allow them to stay, and this is leading to a rural brain drain and depopulation. This is now being exacerbated by the fact that lecturers at one of the main places for rural study, the SRUC, are having to undergo strike action to get their voices heard, as their pay and grading has fallen significantly below the norms across both further and higher education. Our lecturers carry out vital work for our citizens who want to continue their studies. So what steps will the Minister commit to help resolve this deadlock?
Minister.
In relation to the first part of Mr Whitfield's question, I don't have the latest figures before me, but the last I saw was that the spread of apprenticeships across the country broadly correlated to population share. That's been the experience in the last few years. In relation to the situation at SRUC, I would, as always, encourage the management and unions to come together. The last thing I think any of us want to see is disruption to learning, disruption to research as well, as of course SRUC is a world leader on. So I would be encouraging management and unions to get together to resolve this situation.
Thank you, Minister. I would remind members asking supplementaries to try and keep them broadly relevant to the initial question, but I congratulate the Minister again on managing to knit those together. Question number five, Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the National Digital Academy.
Cabinet Secretary.
Work on developing a National Digital Academy is at an early stage. Its development will build on learning from the pandemic, including the National e-learning offer, which built on the GLOW and eSchool programmes. Over the coming year, we will engage with young people in particular to understand fully how remote learning has worked for them over the pandemic and how it can support their ongoing learning. A number of colleges already offer SCQF Level 6 courses and qualifications, including hires remotely, and work will take place to understand how these already support the provision of courses outside traditional educational settings.
Siobhan Brown.
I welcome that response from the Cabinet Secretary. I believe that the implementation of the Digital Academy will give a lot of people comfort, especially some of our children who have missed a lot of school during the pandemic and didn't get the exam results that they needed for the course that they wished to get into. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, what other steps are being taken to support senior phase learners across Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it is very important that we do support our senior phase students. They have gone through an incredibly difficult year over the pandemic, and it is important that we support them. So, for example, the work that has already been announced includes eSchool learning and, of course, the investment that we've already put in to local authorities and to schools directly through the Scottish Attainment Challenge and PEF funding. It will assist schools to be able to develop what is right for them in their situations and in their community to be able to support their pupils during this time. That may, and I'm sure will, include online learning at some points, and we will learn from this as we go forward to see what more can be done as we build the National Digital Academy.
Thank you. Question number six, Sarah Boyack, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how many additional qualified teachers of children and young people with vision impairment will be recruited as part of its commitment to recruit 1,000 new teachers and 500 pupil support assistants in the next academic year.
Cabinet Secretary.
The recruitment and employment of teachers are matters for individual local authorities. Since the pandemic, we have provided £240 million to support educational staffing, including our commitment to support the recruitment of 1,000 additional teachers and 500 support staff. Furthermore, we've provided £145.5 million baselined into the 2022 local government settlement to support sustainable employment for these additional staff. We're committed to an additional 3,500 teachers by the end of the parliamentary term. The Scottish Government is committed to increasing the capacity and expertise of school staff to support pupils with visual impairments, and we fund the Scottish Sensory Centre to provide specialist training to school staff to support pupils with sensory impairment.
Sarah Boyack.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer, but say that in the last decade, the number of visually impaired young people in our schools has doubled, and that a large number of the QTVI teachers reach retirement age in the next decade. And the quickest route to qualification is postgraduate, which is around £9,500. And if you do the competence route, it takes a lot longer. So will the Scottish Government, or the Cabinet Secretary rather, agree to go and look at this issue? Because we potentially have a shortage of QTVI teachers over the next decade, and we need action now to make sure that our young people don't miss out on the skills and experience that particularly those who are visually impaired definitely need.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Sarah Boyack for this question, which does raise a very, very important issue. I will give her the assurance today that we will look at this further. As a government, we are, of course, aware of this issue and also of the campaign that has been recently organised by Sight Scotland, for example, on this issue. But I'm certainly more than happy to take this issue away again and look at it further.
Thank you. And question number seven, Alistair Allen.
To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to promote Scottish literature in schools.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government does not prescribe literature to be used in schools. However, Curriculum for Excellence provides schools and practitioners with the opportunity to make choices about the literature that is studied in schools to reflect the circumstances and needs of learners, and this will often include the use of Scottish texts. SQA National 5 and Higher English courses have a strong focus on Scottish literature, allowing candidates to develop an awareness and an appreciation of Scotland's rich social and cultural heritage.
Dr. Allen.
I thank the Minister for that reply. Can the Minister say whether the Government feels there are lessons to learn from other countries around Europe, where learning extensively about their country's literature is almost without exception regarded as an essential outcome of secondary education?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think Dr. Allen raises a very, very important point. Clearly, this government is always keen to learn opportunities from other countries in this and other areas of education. For example, obviously, we recently commissioned OECD to review the Curriculum for Excellence and its implementation, precisely because we are determined to learn that good practice from abroad. As I outlined in my earlier response, Curriculum for Excellence does provide young people with opportunity to engage with a range of literature, including Scottish texts, and I'm sure that that is being done across the country with great enthusiasm by our teachers and our learners.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions. Question number eight wasn't lodged, so that does conclude portfolio questions. I note that all the members that need to be present for the next item of business are here, so we'll move on to that shortly.